The Special Air Service, Britain's original special forces, and the granddaddy of all modern special forces. The SAS is the benchmark by which every other special forces unit is measured, and their tactics and training methods have been replicated all over the world. The history of the SAS begins in the deserts of World War II, and their feats of daring are the stuff of legend and continue to this day in the global war on terrorism. One of the toughest special forces outfits in the world to enter into, the SAS requires the absolute best out of every recruit. Many apply each year to join this legendary service, and many fail and are washed out of training. What about you, though? Think you've got what it takes to join the elite SAS? SAS selection takes place across several phases of selection, with selection phase 1, known as endurance, taking place over 3 grueling weeks. Any dummy can be physically fit and carry a heavy pack, but selection phase 1 will weed out the dumb brutes and leave behind only the mentally and physically strong. For phase 1, you'll head out to the countryside in South Wales, but don't expect a picnic, because you'll immediately be put to marching across varying routes. Initially, you'll carry a pack loaded up with the essential gear, such as a rain poncho, sleeping bag, first aid kit, and distress flares. Though you can expect that as the distance you're forced to march increases, so does the weight. You'll carry your food with you too, which consists of some bread rolls, a few Mars candy bars, and potato chips, along with a 24-hour ration pack that can only be opened in an emergency. Forced to march endlessly, low on food and sleep, this phase isn't just testing your physical fitness, but your mental fitness as well. Unlike in most other Special Forces candidate programs, here you won't have to deal with instructors screaming at you and breathing down your neck. Instead, SAS instructors purposefully leave you completely to your own devices, offering no encouragement, but no chastisement either. You will pass or fail completely of your own volition. And you better be good at disciplining temptation too, because while you may be starving, opening up that 24-hour emergency ration pack without permission is grounds for rejection. Attention to detail is critical for an SAS soldier, so as long as you're trying to drag yourself through another day-long march on your blistered feet, you should expect instructors to occasionally quiz you about landmarks you may have just passed. The purpose is to test your alertness and see how well you can pay attention while physically miserable. One candidate said he was asked how many supports were on a bridge he had just crossed over during his march. Eventually, you'll face the final test, a grueling 40-mile march up and down hills, carrying 55 pounds of gear and an assault rifle to boot. Not only will you have to accurately navigate your own course, but you'll only have 22 hours to complete the course. Failure means your application process is over, and you'll return to your home unit. Just because you pass, though, don't expect that you're on to the next official phase, because instructors will have been carefully evaluating you the entire time. If they suspect you aren't the right stuff, it won't matter how fast you completed your course or how much weight you can carry. You'll be rejected and sent back to your home unit. Out of 200 candidates, only around 30 to 40 will make it past this phase and move on to the next phase, jungle training. Like most of SAS's training, the exact details of what goes on in the jungle phase are classified. What is known, though, is that trainees will learn jungle survival skills, as well as how to conduct patrols deep behind enemy lines and live off the land for weeks at a time. Trainees will learn how to operate as a 4-man unit and live on rations, remaining undetected as they carry out their mission. A strong emphasis on physical fitness will also see trainees hit the gym every day, and after the gym, there will be a great deal of time spent out on the range. There, you'll learn how to operate standard bits of SAS gear, to include battle rifles, recoilless rifles, grenade launchers, and light machine guns. Trainees will also learn how to operate many other weapons in use across the world. An SAS soldier must know how to pick up a weapon in a foreign battlefield and use it effectively if he needs to. You'll also undergo training on setting up ambushes as well as responding to enemy ambushes. You'll be trained in advanced scouting techniques and how to observe your environment for subtle changes that could signal a hidden enemy patrol or a sniper perched in waiting. Detecting changes in color, shadows, or even small movements can mean the difference between life and death for an SAS operative deep behind enemy lines. As with many other Special Forces training programs, you'll also learn advanced defensive driving techniques, enabling a quick getaway in any hostile situation. These are many of the same techniques that police use for stopping speeding drivers, but you'll learn how to avoid those same techniques and not be stopped yourself. We hope you like blowing things up, because you'll also be learning how to handle a variety of explosives. And because explosions typically mean wounded, you'll receive extensive medical training that can be quickly deployed out in the field. One of the most important jobs that Special Forces operators do in war is reconnaissance. And so you'll learn how to establish listening posts and observation posts, and covertly observe an enemy. To aid you in your mission, you'll learn how to use a variety of secure communications gear, such as satellite radios, and how to avoid getting pinned down by the enemy due to your electronic emissions. Lastly, you'll undergo extensive hand-to-hand and close-quarters combat techniques, and become an expert in breaching and assaulting enemy structures. To make it to the end of this phase, you'll be amongst the 15 to 20 who didn't get sick from the jungle environment and drop out, or weren't washed out by instructors. Don't start congratulating yourself yet, though, because the ultimate test is coming up next. Part 1 of your final test is a 3-day escape and evasion course. You'll be given a ratty old coat, boots that may be held together with only strings, and no food or water. You'll have a short head start and must evade capture for 3 days by a hunter force equipped with dogs and modern equipment. For these 3 days, you must live off the land while evading your pursuers. And though officially you're barred from entering any structures, some crafty trainees may sneak their way into a civilian property and maybe even have a local take them in. As with most Special Forces tests, cheating is simply another creative way of accomplishing the required objective, as long as you aren't caught, that is. The second part of your final test will take place when you're captured or at the end of the 3 days. If you've managed to avoid capture, then you'll be expected to return to a designated location at the end of the 3rd day. Once there, you'll be handcuffed, have a bag thrown over your head, and be taken to a remote location. Instructors will then attempt to break you down mentally. You'll be placed in stress positions and forced to hold them for hours at a time. You may be locked in a cage the size of a dog kennel, while instructors bash the roof of it with chains. Instructors will strip you nude in front of female instructors who will mock the size of your manhood. It's all a mental game, meant to soften you up for the pending interrogation sessions. After enough humiliation and mental torture, you'll be thrown into a room with an interrogator, and your job will be to only reveal the big four to him or her: your name, rank, serial number, and date of birth. Giving the interrogator any information other than that will lead to your immediate expulsion from SAS training. That's it, the end of the line for you. If you make it through this final phase, then you can feel proud of accomplishing what very few people have ever done. You'll receive the beige beret with the winged dagger insignia, and officially become a member of the British Special Air Service. However, maybe celebrate modestly, because you'll be on probation until you finish your continuation training, and sadly, many soldiers are returned to their home unit during this phase. If that happens to you, you'll at least have worn the beret for a short time, and that's an accomplishment in and of itself. If you make it through training, though, you'll join the 22nd Special Air Service Regiment, which consists of 4 active squadrons, A, B, D, and G. Each squadron is made up of around 60 men, meaning there's roughly 240 active-duty SAS soldiers at a time in the British military, with 2 reserve regiments, the 21st and 23rd SAS. This is in sharp contrast to the approximately 2,000 Navy SEALs the US military has, but that's due to the smaller size of the British military. Amongst each SAS squadron are 4 troops, and each troop specializes in a different area of expertise. The air troop is specialized in parachute insertions, including static line insertions and halo jumps deep behind enemy lines. The boat troop is specialized in amphibious operations, such as inserting into hostile beaches via submarines, a favorite tactic of US SEALs. Interestingly, SAS and American SEALs work so closely together that often SAS soldiers will deploy from an American submarine specially outfitted to deliver special forces under the cover of the waves. Mobility troop soldiers specialize in handling any number of vehicles. You can think of them as the getaway drivers of the SAS. Mountain troops are trained in Arctic warfare and navigating and surviving in dangerous mountainous terrain. SAS mountain troops work closely with American and French special forces in the mountain regions of Afghanistan, hunting down Taliban and Al-Qaeda fighters in deep mountain complexes. The close-knit relationship between SAS and American special forces means that both nations share many of the same tactics and training techniques, and an SAS soldier is always welcome aboard any American aircraft or boat. If you had joined the SAS in the early 2000s, you may have been a part of the legendary Task Force 88, easily the deadliest fighting force ever assembled on planet Earth. Immediately after Saddam Hussein's government was ousted from power, Task Force 88 was formed to hunt down the former dictator and his supporters. And over the years, their job evolved to becoming the premier hunter-killers of NATO's war against terrorist leaders in Iraq and Afghanistan. Most of their deeds are shrouded in extreme secrecy, though it's known that TF-88 was responsible for killing one of the key members of the insurgency, Al-Zarqawi. At its height, Task Force 88 was made up of Task Force Black, an SAS Sabre squadron supported by specialist boat service operators. Task Force Blue was made up of the legendary SEAL Team 6. Task Force Green was made up of operatives from America's Delta Force. And Task Force Orange was made up of the single most secretive Special Forces operators in the world, America's Intelligence Support Activity, a Special Forces unit whose job is to find actionable intelligence for other Special Forces units and which the Pentagon denies any official knowledge of. Task Force 88 was an example of the close-knit relationship between the Special Air Service and its American counterparts, and that relationship continues to this day in unacknowledged conflicts all around the world. If you think you've got what it takes to make it through SAS selection after watching our video, maybe you too will be working side by side with the world's best, hunting down bad guys in jungles, deserts, and mountains all over the globe. Now that you've watched this adrenaline-packed video, maybe it's time to chill out with this video over here. And if that one doesn't do it for you, maybe click this one instead. Click one of the two videos, though, for the love of Queen and country.